Now, how many of you here love Big Mac meals? Now, come on, I'm a psychiatrist. You can tell me, you know, it's confidential information, it's protected by HIPAA rules. You can tell me, how many of you love Big Macs? Come on. Of course, of course. How many of you have cravings for broccoli? Cravings for broccoli. I mean, you can see there's variation in a species, but there's very few. All right, why? The reason for this is that if you understand the psychology of the Big Mac meal, you understand the psychology of religion. I'm serious. I mean, let me show you this, okay? We evolved adaptations for things that were crucial and rare. Sugars of ripe fruit, fat of lean game meat, of salt. Those were crucial adaptations in our past. And the modern world creates a novel form of it that comes from those adaptations, but hijacks them with supernormal stimuli. Okay, not ripe fruit, but a Coca-Cola. Not lean game meat, but you know, a fat hamburger. French fries soaked in meat juice. And it creates these supernormal stimuli, but they're based on ancient adaptations. Let me just take you now on a little bit of a tour of some of these cognitive mechanisms. The first is decoupled cognition. Now, this is a fancy word for we can decouple our cognition in time. Since I have been talking, I will guarantee you that everybody in this room has thought of, while you're listening to me and paying close attention, you have thought of a conversation you have had with somebody in the past, or you are thinking about a conversation you're going to have with somebody later on today. As I'm talking right now, every one of us in this room can imagine and conduct in our heads a conversation with President Obama. Okay? It is, as you can see, it's extraordinary, and it's crucial for memory, for planning. Absolutely one of the essences of our humanity. It allows us these complex interactions with unseen others, complex social interactions with unseen others. You can see that it's just one little step to, you know, communicating with a dead ancestor. I don't know about you, but I'm getting to the age where a lot of those near and dear to me have died, and I catch myself still talking to them. It's one step further to communicating to a god or gods. Hyperactive agency detection. All of us will mistake a shadow for a burglar. We will never mistake a burglar for a shadow. We have these hyperactive agency detection mechanisms. If we were to hear a loud bang right now, we would all startle, and we would assume it was not an accident, it was agency and probably human agency. Now, you may reasonably ask, well, okay, how does decoupled cognition interacting with another, how does hyperactive agency, how does that lead to supernatural figures, though? I mean, to, you know, supernatural burglars. Okay, how do you get the next level up from human to supernatural? This. Your minds fill in, there are no lines there, but your minds see that square and fill in the lines. It's called intuitive reasoning. And it underlines the essence of religious ideas, which are minimally counterintuitive worlds, MCIs. Now, what is this? It's an optimal compromise between the interesting and the expected. And it gives us attention-arresting and memorable things. Let me illustrate. If I tell you that big tree out in front of the conference center will do your taxes, wash your laundry, reprogram your computer, you're simply not going to believe me. But if I tell you that tree, on the night of a full moon, will hear your wishes and grant them, you might be vulnerable to believing that. Not this audience, but many people. But you might be vulnerable to it, because there's just one slight twist, but everything you know about trees is intuitively in there. and you fill in the blanks. Now, think of the Judeo-Christian God. Okay? He's everywhere. There's a little twist of physics, but it's just a guy. And you fill in the blanks. You don't even think about it, but you fill in the blanks. There's no violation of basic human assumptions. He's a guy. He can understand my southern accented English. All the assumptions about humanness are filled in. There's just one little twist. And all religious ideas have these supernatural templates. They have a counterintuitive physical property, like, you know, God is everywhere. A counterintuitive piece of biology, the virgin birth. But Mary is otherwise just a girl. Counterintuitive psychology, you know, God knows what I'm thinking. But if he knows what I'm thinking, why do I still have to pray to him? Why do I still have to talk to him? Because again, those basic assumptions about humanness are all still intact. That's why we believe it, that's why we'll start to accept it, and that's why it sticks in our heads. There's always, always the attribution of mental states, human mental states. Look at any religious idea. You know, go back to your college courses, think about any religious system, any religious ideas you know of, and they fit this model.